Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Personality, What Makes You the Way You Are, by Daniel Nettle, read by Matthew Waterson. Publisher's note: this audiobook refers to tables included in the print and ebook editions of the book. At every single moment of one's life, one is what one is going to be, no less than what one has been. Oscar Wilde, De Profundis. Introduction. I do not plead guilty to a shallow view of human nature when I propose to apply, as it were, a foot rule to its heights and depths. Francis Galton. Lee is a successful, smart business executive, rising 35 and rising through the ranks at the same time. He is considered effective and dynamic at work. In fact, it's more than that. He does not suffer fools gladly, and if he thinks colleagues or suppliers are trying to pull one over on him, he is quick to speak his mind. He can be very cutting and fly into a deep rage, during which he will tell people what he thinks of them and their behavior without sparing their blushes. As a result, though he is good at what he does, he builds up enemies. He has moved firms a few times or had to be moved between departments because he gets into feuds and standoffs. Some more conciliatory colleague will have to step in to calm the waters, or simply to ensure that Lee and his latest enemy don't have to deal with each other. Outside of work, there are quite a lot of people Lee doesn't like. He has been to a fair few exotic countries and, for at least some of these, he has decided that he hates the natives. They are too rude or too slow or invade his personal space. He hates people who cut him up on the road or barge in front of him in line or make him wait. He is quick to get angry when this happens and not averse to a muttered, usually scatological insult. We should not assume that Lee doesn't like to socialize. In fact, he loves to go out and party. However, if the people at the party are the wrong type of people or they are partying in the wrong way, he is quickly bored and frankly annoyed at having wasted his evening. Even a good party might end up with Lee in a screaming row with some fool who doesn't share his politics or tastes. Lee has a core of good friends, and these friendships have lasted, but they are not without conflict. In fact, in each, there is a history of strong arguments, altercations, and sulks, as well as reconciliations. Love is a similar story. There always seem to be disagreements, or the other person turns out to be needy, annoying, or inadequate in some way. Women tend to end up saying Lee is selfish or inconsiderate, and a partner who is compatible for the long haul is still not in sight. Julian is very different from Lee. He is, currently, a writer for a travel magazine. This job allows him to travel all over the world, researching stories on Indian religious festivals and the Trans-Siberian Railway. Travel is his current passion, though it was not always so. He studied music at college and, immediately after graduation, threw himself with passion into his band, which performed an unusual combination of traditional Middle Eastern music and modern pop. Guided mainly by his motivating enthusiasm, the band did quite well in their region for a few years, though doing quite well in the music business is not as glamorous as it might seem. It means playing live, a lot, but to maybe 30 or 50 people, and sleeping in vans and sharing flats with numerous others of uncertain hygiene. These costs are not to be questioned, though, since music is clearly everything. A couple of years into the life of the band, Julian began to become disillusioned, and for a period became low and withdrawn. He felt that his life with his partner, one of the band's Lebanese backing singers, was becoming repetitive and joyless, and he worried about what would happen to them in the end. What had previously seemed incredibly exciting flipped into seeming like a treadmill on which they would never get anywhere. Julian eventually left both the band and his partner and, much to the surprise of his friends, enrolled in a master's degree in business management. Julian, the rock and roller in a business suit? Julian would have none of it. Business is really interesting. It's about people, about how they interact. In fact, it's creative. It's a way of bringing about new relationships and better ways of living. Needless to say, that didn't last. By the time of graduation, Julian could only see the entrapment of 30 years of 9-to-5 working in an office ahead of him. This time he became really depressed and saw both a doctor who prescribed antidepressants and a counselor who introduced him to some of the more new age elements of psychotherapy. For a while, he made his living, with his then-girlfriend, doing Reiki, psychodrama, and Indian head massage, the two of them living frugally but healthily in a large rambling farmhouse in a remote spot. They didn't need foreign holidays, so vivifying and healthy was the way they lived all year round. That lasted 3 years, until a rift with his partner and disillusion with the therapies he was practicing led Julian into his glummest spirits yet. He resolved to travel the world for a year to revitalize himself and, through a series of chance encounters, ended up writing features for the travel magazine. He loves his job. He's been doing it for a year and has a fabulous French girlfriend who is a photographer. Clearly, traveling and travel writing is what he has always been working towards. Their lives are so different, Lee and Julian, and yet they are the same age and sex. We can easily imagine them both coming from fairly normal middle-class backgrounds, being of similar intelligence and educational attainment, and having been exposed to broadly similar cultural expectations and values. In fact, it is no stretch of the imagination, given our experience of human beings, to imagine two people having essentially the same set of experiences growing up, and yet having adult lives at least as different from each other as those of Lee and Julian. If the initial social conditions were so similar, then what could possibly account for two human lives coming out so differently? Non-psychologists I talk to have strong intuitions about this question. What brings about the different outcomes is, they say, the different personalities or temperaments or characters of the two individuals involved. What is personality, I ask? They tell me that it is something internal, stable, inherent to the person, something which stands in a causal relationship to their specific choices, motivations, reactions, and obstacles when faced with a stream of events. A clue to personality being at work, they tell me, is a kind of thematic recurrence within the events of a life. For example, over the course of a few years, Lee eventually ends up hostile about most of the people he has to work with. In the same way, he is quite likely to end up being hostile about someone he has to sit next to on a train journey or flight. The timescale is quite different, and the stakes and demands of the interaction are very different. But the fact that, sooner or later, another person in close proximity is likely to do something to annoy him recurs as a leitmotif across Lee's life. A leitmotif, I suspect, Lee will never consider, since he finds psychologists and psychology books really annoying. Similarly for Julian, there are a number of recurring patterns. Each of the domains of fusion music, psychodrama, self-sufficient farm living, and travel writing is unusual and creative, but Julian has been drawn to them all within a short life. It is as if there is a constant quest for new ways of experiencing the world and expressing his experience of it. There is also a characteristic pattern to his life choices. He finds a new domain and becomes tremendously, infectiously excited and activated by it. This serves him very well in getting his new projects established. For a while, he simply will not hear of the drawbacks or limitations. Over time, though, these feelings fade, and in place of enthusiasm come doubt and worry about the future. For despite his energy, Julian can be a very worried and sad person. The pattern that describes Julian's career activities also describes his relationships. These have typically lasted 2 or 3 years and consisted of an initial phase of great passion, during which his family's mild suggestions of unsuitability are just so ridiculous, unintuitive, and superficial, followed by a period of mounting unhappiness, restlessness, and withdrawal, during which his family's resigned attempts to get on with his chosen paramour are resented. How can they not see that she is not what I need? It is the lot of parents to always be in the wrong. This phase is followed by a period of more or less nervy adjustment and recuperation before the next passion takes hold. Can this leitmotif of initial enthusiasm, followed by withdrawal and denial, be detected at any other level? As I imagine him, Julian has dozens of unopened books that he brought home from the bookshop with a triumphant, "Nietzsche is so interesting. I'm going to read everything he ever wrote." There is a bread maker, bought in a flurry of excitement but used twice, a violin, played once, and a full-sized loom. Each of these items represents a spurt of enthusiasm and a desire to begin something unusual, followed by either insufficient reward to sustain the behavior or a slough of demotivating negative emotion. This is the same pattern as the relationships and jobs, but over a different scale. The same pattern appearing at different scales is a very interesting property. It is, for example, a property of those exquisite topographies called fractals, much beloved of complexity theorists and graphic designers. In a fractal, you see the same pattern whether you look at a very large section or whether you zoom in on a very small one. The part represents the whole and vice versa. Fractals have this property because of the nature of the mathematical functions that generate them. Human personalities are rather like fractals. It is not just that what we do in the large-scale narratives of our lives, love, career, friendships, tends to be somewhat consistent over time, with us often repeating the same kinds of triumphs or mistakes. Rather, what we do in tiny interactions like the way we shop, or dress, or talk to a stranger on a train, or decorate our houses, shows the same kinds of patterns as can be observed from examining a whole life. We often find ourselves saying, "That is just so typical of Bob." We say this because what people do in the set of situations we have observed them in is a reasonable guide to what they will do in a set of future situations, including quite different ones. Just as the self-consistent properties of fractals are generated by the mathematical functions that define them, so these self-consistent properties of personality seem as if they are generated by some physical property of the nervous system of the person in question. In other words, we feel that talking about someone's personality is a shorthand way for talking about the way that person's particular nervous system is wired up. This book is about the psychology of personality. I aim to vindicate the idea that people have enduring personality dispositions which partly predict what they will do and which stem from the way their nervous systems are wired up. I also wish to introduce the science behind the study of personality, how we measure personality, what the measures mean, what they predict, and why personality variation exists in the first place. Personality psychology has, until recently, had a rather low status compared to other branches of psychology. It has been perceived as based on flimsy evidence, internally divided and far removed from the hard science end of psychology. There may once have been some justice in these views, but I believe that things have changed. In fact, a renaissance is underway in the study of personality, a renaissance I hope to herald in this book. There are several reasons why the time is right for the renaissance. First, we at last have a set of personality concepts we can use that is firmly based on evidence and which we psychologists can agree on. This set of concepts is called the five-factor model of personality, or the Big Five. The five-factor model has emerged from a welter of research over the last few decades and looks to be the most comprehensive, reliable, and useful framework for discussing human personality that we have ever had. Chapter 1. The idea of the model is that there are five major dimensions along which all human characters vary. Thus, any individual can be given five scores that will tell us a great deal about the ways they are liable to behave through their lives. The emergence of the five-factor model is very useful because the field of personality research had long been plagued by different people using different notions. Formerly, one psychologist might give you a score for reward dependence and harm avoidance, whilst another might classify you as a thinking, feeling, sensing, or intuiting type. This led to a frustrating profusion of different studies measuring different constructs without seeming to relate to each other in any systematic way. All this added to the low status of personality research as a scientific endeavor. As long ago as 1958, Gordon Allport complained that each assessor has his own pet units and uses a pet battery of diagnostic devices, and things got worse in the ensuing decades. The five-factor model introduced some order into the mess. It's not that all those other constructs were necessarily invalid. It's just that most constructs that had previously been measured can actually be subsumed under the five-factor framework. Either they measure one of the Big Five, or a subpart of one of them, or an amalgam of two of them. This is enormously useful, as we can quickly tidy the field up very significantly and give people a fully portable framework for understanding and characterizing the main differences between people. To quote the influential personality psychologists Paul Coster and Robert McRae, the five-factor model is the Christmas tree on which all the particular findings of personality research can be arranged. I am using the five-factor model as my Christmas tree in this book too. Each one of the Big Five is the subject of one chapter, chapters 3-7 inclusive. Another reason that we are ready for a renaissance of personality studies is the staggering progress of neuroscience, fueled in particular by brain imaging techniques such as PET scanning and fMRI, which we will meet frequently later in the book. These techniques allow us to look at the structure and functioning of the human brain non-invasively in alive, awake, thinking individuals. The first flurry of activity using these new technologies was about finding out how brains in general worked, which regions were always associated with which types of functions. But a second phase has become concerned with the variation between individuals. Different brain structures have different relative sizes within the normal population, and there is a great deal of variation between individuals in the way their brains respond metabolically to particular tasks. A new science is emerging of individual differences in brain structure and functioning, and the results of this science can be mapped back to the Big Five personality dimensions, as we shall see. The third area contributing to the renaissance of interest in personality is human genetics and genomics. The sequencing of the human genome was completed in 2001. Just as in brain imaging, the first concern was understanding people in general, not as individuals. The initial goal of the Human Genome Project was thus to describe the common structure of the 25 to 30,000 genes that we all share, and was based on a consensus sequence of around 200 individuals' DNA. The consensus sequence has now been published, and there is a growing interest in genetic individuality. Many of those 25 to 30,000 genes exist in several slightly different variant forms. We know that people vary enormously in disease liabilities, response to particular drugs, vulnerability to specific types of psychological problems, and many other ways, and we are beginning to understand how these predispositions relate to which of the possible genetic variants they are carrying. We all know our blood group, and in the not-too-distant future, we can envisage a world in which we will get our personal genome sequenced in order to know our vulnerability to breast cancer or heart disease, or likely response to a particular type of drug. This burgeoning science of genetic individuality can also be linked back to personality, since, as we shall see, your personality is partly determined by which genetic variants you are carrying. The final reason why the time is right for a personality renaissance is to do with the diffusion of evolutionary thinking. Evolutionary thinking is about asking the ultimate question of how the population got to be the way it is through natural selection, alongside the proximate question of which genes or bits of brain are involved. Evolutionary thinking is becoming much more widespread in psychology, and it is lending a new depth and explanatory power to several different areas of the field. Just as in the other areas of science discussed before, the initial concern of evolutionary psychologists was with understanding the design of the mental mechanisms we all share, and so at first, they gave relatively little thought to differences between individuals. Only a few small forays of evolutionary thought into the psychology of personality were made. However, that is also changing. We know that there are temperamental differences between individuals in species other than humans. An evolutionary perspective on such variation raises a host of good questions. Why is the variation there? Will natural selection ultimately eliminate it or lead to its increase? Under what circumstances, indeed, does natural selection allow variation to persist within a population? These questions will infuse our thinking about personality traits throughout this book. This book is aimed at the interested general listener, rather than just my academic colleagues. In this spirit, I will not dwell on the kinds of technical details and full background to every claim that would normally be found in a research paper or monograph. Those wishing to find citations and ancillary details are directed to the endnotes, though even these offer pointers and key references rather than a complete literature review. Those who can live without the academic stuff should be able to ignore the notes completely without missing anything vital to the argument. Even in this, hopefully, user-friendly presentation, I will try to give a judicious and evidence-based account of current knowledge and be fair in separating what we know from what is, as yet, guesswork. My account is based on several elements: the existing literature, created by many esteemed colleagues, some recent personality studies of my own, and a remarkable set of life stories sent to me by correspondents from all over the world. These were individuals who had been participants in my research, and for whom I thus had five-factor personality data. At my request, they kindly wrote to me, often at length, about their lives, their feelings, and their relationships with others in ways that have been most enlightening, even if they have sometimes made writing this book harder rather than easier, since they make the picture more complex. Where I draw on their stories, I have, of course, disguised details to ensure their anonymity. By the way, Lee and Julian are not examples of these life stories. They are the only fictional case studies in this book. The rest are drawn from life. I solicited the life stories because I suspected that most listeners of this book were more interested in understanding people than in understanding personality theory for theory's sake. Above all, if you are hearing this, I suspect you want to know about and understand your own personality. We have to explore a couple of preliminary but vital issues. First, in Chapter 1, What is a Personality Trait? And then in Chapter 2, Why does evolution allow biological differences between individuals of the same species to persist? 1. Character matters. Personality is and does something. It is what lies behind specific acts and within the individual. Gordon Allport. It might be conventional to begin with Hippocrates and his ideas about the four humors, or with some other ancient conception of personality types. I prefer, however, to begin our story with an article published by Sir Francis Galton in the Fortnightly Review for 1884 entitled The Measurement of Character. Galton is an apt place to begin for a number of reasons. As Charles Darwin's first cousin, Galton was an early champion of evolution and of the view that evolution is relevant to humans. The way he could think of applying it was filtered through his Victorian preconceptions about society and societies, and so does not seem appropriate to us today. However, his basic intuition that the theory of natural selection would ultimately have to inform our thinking about everything people do has turned out to be correct. A second reason for interest in Galton is that it was he who first realized that studies of how characteristics ran in families, and particularly studies of twins, were the key to unlocking the contribution of nature and nurture to human variation. This insight lies behind a whole scientific field known as behavior genetics, a field that has flourished since Galton's time and whose results we will meet later on. Finally, Galton is noteworthy because he had a very modern preoccupation with measurement. Galton was obsessed with trying to find practical measures for obscure bits of human behavior. In 1885, he published a paper in Nature entitled The Measurement of Fidget. In this he notes, from his own extensive observations, that in a large gathering such as a lecture, audience members fidget around once a minute on average. However, when the lecturer really holds their attention with a point, this rate is diminished by around a half, and moreover, the fidgeting changes. The period of the movements reduces. An enthralled audience member gets their movement over as quickly as possible, whereas a bored one draws it out. And the angle of deviation of the body from the upright, which sailors will know as the yaw, also reduces. Thus, a quick index of how bored an audience is at any point in time would be, on average, how far from vertically upright they were. Galton commends these insights to the reader as promising to give numerical expression to the amount of boredom expressed by the audience generally during the reading of any particular memoir. Quirky as this paper is, it is very modern. Many philosophers before Galton had speculated about human traits, but few had seen that none of this was worth the candle, scientifically at any rate, if the traits in question could not be measured. Most of the work in scientific psychology consists in trying to come up with good measures of things and showing that they are good measures. Indeed, a concern with measurement is precisely what distinguishes academically respectable psychology from psychology of other kinds. Galton measured the weights of livestock and aristocrats, the speeds of reaction times, the sizes of heads, the shapes of fingerprints, and many other characteristics. His special contribution to personality theory was that he began to think about how this thing, personality, might be measured, and thus brought within the fold of scientifically studyable entities. In his 1884 article, he notes the general desirability of measuring personality and comes up with some suggestions. One is that we look at natural language. Using a thesaurus, he estimates that there are at least 1,000 terms describing people's characters in the English language, but these contain a good deal of redundancy, since many of them are synonyms or antonyms. This casual observation of Galton's began what is known as lexical work in personality, which analyzes the set of descriptive terms occurring in languages as a basis for understanding the ways in which people differ. The assumption is that the semantics of natural language has developed in such a way as to mirror the important differences that exist in the world. I have little more to say about lexical work here, but it has been very important indeed in the development of the five-factor model in particular. Galton also proposes that people have characteristically different levels of emotional reactivity, again a notion that has turned out to have some mileage in it, and suggests that we could get an index of character by subjecting people to small impromptu emotional trials to see how they respond. Boo! The magnitude of their response would tell us about the arousability of their emotions in general, which would be predictively useful when thinking about larger trials they might face in real life. Sir Francis is characteristically bullish about how easy this would be to do. I feel sure that if two or three experimenters were to act zealously and judiciously as secret accomplices, they would soon collect abundant statistics of conduct. I feel sure they would too, but I am less sure that research ethics committees would be pleased. Finally, Galton notes the desirability of linking these reactions to physiology. If some people are more emotionally arousable than others, then this should show up in changes in heart rate or some other physiological parameters. There were technical limitations to doing this in 1884, but again, it is a very modern idea which prefigures the contemporary interest in linking personality constructs to underlying neurobiological mechanisms. Thus, Galton has already envisioned, at least in principle, many of the methods of modern personality psychology. What is missing from his account is the most common source of personality data today, namely ratings. Much modern personality work is based on people's self-reported ratings of what they are like, or, more rarely, of what someone else is like. It is a fortunate development for personality psychology that data of this kind have turned out to be quite reliable, since they are the quickest and easiest of data to collect. Systematic empirical work on personality began a few decades after Galton, but this is not the place for a history of personality psychology. Suffice it to say for current purposes that the central notion of personality psychology is the trait. A trait is a continuum along which individuals vary. Nervousness might be a trait, for example, or speed of reaction. Note, at this point, that the same name is often used for one end of a trait and for the trait itself. Thus, the trait of nervousness means the continuum from never at all nervous to often severely nervous. Similarly, the trait of extroversion means the continuum from not at all extroverted to extremely extroverted. You can never observe a trait directly. Instead, you infer a person's level of the trait through their behavior. No one will be nervous all the time, but some people might be nervous more often and over a wider range of circumstances than others. This propensity to nervousness to qualify as a trait would have to be fairly consistent over time. By the way, the big five are traits. I think people call it the five factor rather than the five trait model because they like the alliteration. Traits are continuous, like height is, rather than discrete, like being an apple versus being a pear. The idea that there is some finite number of discrete types of human character is enduringly popular in some quarters, but there is no basis to it. The architecture of traits is the same across persons, and their levels alone differ. That is, everyone has all of the five factors of personality, just as everyone has a height and a weight. Where we differ is the magnitude of the height and the weight, or the score along each of the five dimensions. Though trait concepts are not derived from neurobiological evidence, many personality psychologists believe that they will turn out to be neurobiologically real. That is to say, although we initially define traits by inferring them from the mass of behavior, if we had perfect knowledge of the structure of the nervous system, Bob is high in neuroticism, could ultimately be translated into statements about the structure of his brain. Thus, trait statements entail predictions about neurobiological and perhaps even genetic differences between people. These are the central tenets of modern personality psychology. Let us then investigate how personality traits are detected and understood. We will do so using some data from a recent study of mine. I asked 545 British adults of a cross-section of ages and backgrounds various questions about themselves, which they had to respond to on scales of 1 to 5. One question asked, "How much time do you spend in social activities?" whilst another asked, "How much do you like to travel?" The correlation between people's ratings of how much time they spend in social activities and how much they like to travel is 0.20. You will recall that a correlation coefficient, known as R, is an index of the extent to which, when one quantity varies, some other quantity varies too. A correlation coefficient of 1 means that varying the first quantity perfectly predicts the way the second will vary. A correlation coefficient of 0 means that when one quantity varies, it gives you no information about the other. A person's height and their weight correlate at about R equals 0.68. This is an index of the fact that if someone is extremely tall, they will probably be relatively heavy, whereas if they are quite small, they will probably be light too. The correlation is not equal to 1 because height and weight do not perfectly predict each other, since two people of the same height can have considerably different weights. Nonetheless, the correlation is substantially greater than zero, which means that if you had to guess how heavy someone was, knowing their height would put you in a better position than if you did not know it. The correlation in my data between liking for travel and time spent in social activities is much lower than that between height and weight, but still significantly greater than zero. This is interesting, since there is little logical connection between the two. A person could love to travel in a solitary manner whilst generally avoiding social company, but that is not the general trend amongst these 545 people. I also asked the people how competitive they were in their own opinion. The correlation between competitiveness and liking for travel was 0.12, and that between competitiveness and time spent in social activities was 0.11. These are modest, but significantly greater than zero. Now, this starts to be interesting. You might imagine that competitive people are so driven that they have no time for travel or socializing, but that is not what the data show. Those who love to socialize and travel also get energized by competition, on average, with a lot of idiosyncratic variation, of course. Next, I asked people how interested they were in sex. Now we have more correlation coefficients to display, and so we need a table, table 1. Interest in sex turns out to be significantly, though modestly, correlated with all the other three. On average, someone who likes to travel will also be a bit more competitive, a bit more interested in sex, and likely to spend a bit more time in social activities than someone who does not like to travel so much. Another way of expressing this is that there is a certain amount of redundancy in the data. If we know someone is really interested in sex, it is not going to surprise us much if they turn out to be a live-hard, play-hard type who loves foreign holidays. The attitude towards sex carries some information about the other attributes, not perfect information by any means, but some information nonetheless. Now let us introduce some more variables. I also asked people to report whether they had ever sought help, informal or professional, because they were feeling down or blue, and in another question, whether they had sought help because of how anxious or worried they were feeling. Help for feeling blue and help for feeling anxious were positively correlated with each other, R equals 0.46. This means someone who had sought serious help for anxiety was more likely than average to have also sought serious help for feeling down. The two tend to occur in the same people. This is not perhaps terribly surprising, but what is more interesting is the relationship of these two to the variables we have already introduced. You might make hypotheses either way. You could suppose that people who are getting out there, socializing hard, driving themselves hard, and having eventful personal lives are going to be exposing themselves to the risk of depression and burnout, and so there will be possible correlations between these two new variables and competitiveness, travel, and so on. On the other hand, you could make the opposite prediction. People who are traveling, socializing, etc. are obviously cheerful and resilient types, so there is going to be a negative correlation between these behaviors and depression and anxiety. This would mean that the higher the score on the traveling and socializing variables, the lower the score on the depression and anxiety variables, and it would mean R was less than zero and somewhere towards negative 1, which is a perfect negative correlation. In fact, none of the correlations between the depression variable and travel, competitiveness, social activity, or interest in sex is significantly different from zero. The same is true for the anxiety variable. If you want to know if someone is vulnerable to depression or anxiety, then knowing if they love to travel or are very interested in sex gives you absolutely no information either way. Whatever determines vulnerability to these conditions is simply unrelated to whatever makes some people more competitive or sexual than others. A problem we soon encounter in this type of work is that the number of correlation coefficients we need to calculate rises exponentially with the number of variables we wish to consider. With two variables, we need to calculate one correlation. With three variables, three correlations. With four variables, six correlations. With five variables, 10 correlations. With 10 variables, 46 correlations, and so on. This is tedious and makes it more and more difficult to apprehend the patterns in the data. This is where we turn to a technique much used in personality research, namely factor analysis. Factor analysis is a way of distilling the redundancy that abounds in data such as these. We have already heard that any one of the four variables concerned with travel, competitiveness, social activity, and interest in sex gives you some information about the other three, so it is partly redundant to display all four values for each person. If we just want to see the main trends in the data, we could perhaps calculate a single variable that subsumes these four. If the value for that person.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.